Okay, we started to get into a discussion of server-side validation. And again, validation is done on the server side largely for two reasons. First of all, it's possible for the user to circumvent anything that you do on the client side simply by turning off JavaScript in their browser. So if your only means of validating code would be validating the form, or the data rather, would be through client-side scripting, then that can easily be defeated. And whether it's accidentally or maliciously or whatever, that would be a consideration. The other reason that we do server-side validation is because we can do more extensive validation on the server. Now, we're not going to do this in this particular example, but remember, the server is more capable of doing sort of the heavy lifting. In other words, things that require database access, for example. And therefore, we might be able to check something on the server side that we're not capable of doing on the client side. The classic example that would be validating a credit card. You know, there's some rules about how a credit card number is structured. It's a certain number of digits long, and it's all numbers. And I think we could even go further to look to say there's only a certain number, there's a limited number of numbers that the credit cards begin with. In other words, not everything's a valid credit card number. And we could tell that just by looking at it. So we could put that kind of validation in the client side because that doesn't require any sort of database interaction. That's just looking for a pattern of numbers. All right. So that we can do via the client side. But what we can't do via the client side is any database interactivity. So we couldn't go up against the database and see that the credit card was stolen, or the credit card was over its limit, or the credit card had expired, or the credit card name didn't match the name that was on the form, or something like that. So that would be some sort of extra validation that we would need to do on the server. Now, in the example that we went over, there was a problem, and I say problem, it's not really a problem in the sense that it's not that it doesn't work, it's that it sort of works in an awkward manner. And that's when we have two pages, when we have a form that submits to a PHP script. So we have a form that you enter some data into. In our case, it was the age and the number of beats per minute, or per 6 seconds, I think. And this form submitted to a process script. So, we enter the form data here, we submit it to a PHP script that does the processing and displays the results. The problem is if we put our validation here, they have to go back there to correct it. So in other words, if this form submits to this page, we look at the data, we see that there's something invalid about it. For example, we see that one of these fields is not numeric, or one of these fields was omitted, or whatever. We could display the error message on this page, but then for them to correct it, they would have to go back to this form, either by hitting the back button, or we could provide a link, or something like that. Now that isn't wrong so much as it's awkward. Ideally, if we think about the way validation works, we want to do the validation, and if it's wrong, we would want to simply allow the user to correct it right then and there on the form. All right? That's the way client-side validation works, right? Because client-side validation works all within this page. So if there's an error, it's going to display the error message, and then they can just re-enter the data and go. Well, with server-side validation, if we do it in this way, we send them to another page, the other page displays that there is an error, they have to go back to that page. That's very awkward and not particularly user-friendly. So if we think of the ways that we can solve this, we might say, well, what about if they enter the data on the form submitted here, and if there's an error, we redisplay the form over on this page? Well, that should set off a little bit of a red flag because then we have the form here and we have the form here. The real answer is to do this. Don't have a separate page, for the processing of the form. Have a page that does what's called a postback. And if you've taken or will take CISS 243, you'll see postbacks in that class as well. The idea of a postback is that when a form submits back to itself. So this page contains two things. It contains a form and it contains a logic to process the form. That way, if there's a server-side validation error, this page can display the error and simply redisplay the form because the form's already on this page. All right? And if everything is okay, it can display the results. So think about it. You go to register on a website. You know, you go to register on Amazon and you get a form. And you enter in all your information. The server-side validation does its thing, and it succeeds, and it adds you as a customer to Amazon. It can then display a message that says, congratulations, you've successfully registered on this site. If, however, there's an error, the stuff to display the form is already there. So we can simply redisplay the form and ask the user to enter the data that they didn't get right. Like you could say, hey, that user ID is already taken, for example. Or you forgot your zip code, or something along those lines. So by having everything in one place, we can provide the user a better user experience. All right? Now, in order to do that, we kind of have to have this page work in two modes. We have to make the page be able to work in a couple different modes. Because the first time in, the first time the page is loaded, the initial page of the load of the page, we want to display the form. So if we go to this page, initially, we want to display the form. So, initially, then after it's submitted, we want to process the form. So, we want to know, we need to know what mode the form is in, what mode the page is in. Is it the initial time, or has the form been submitted? And any idea how we can tell that? How we can tell if the page is loaded for the first time, or if we've submitted it? What would be the difference in the request that the server would get for the initial load versus we've clicked the submit button? I don't necessarily expect you to know this, but you might know this. I don't know. So I won't stand up here all day because this is kind of a tough question. You'll know that based on if there's something on the query string. When the page loads initially, let's say, the URL is going to be form.php, let's say. There's nothing on the query string. That indicates the page has initially been loaded. When we submit the form, we're going to see something like this. Form.php ? Text box equals something, and radio button equals something, and blah, blah, blah. So we can write code to look to see if there's something on the query string. If there's something on the query string, it's the second time through. So we know that we're in this mode, and so we know we do this thing. If, however, we are not, there's nothing on the query string, we know it must be the initial load, so we display the form. Now, server-side validation makes this a little more complicated. All right? Because if it's not the first time, if it's see if there's any errors. And then, if errors, we display the form. Otherwise, we process the form. So there's sort of three things that we have to distinguish in order to know how to handle this if we're doing a postback. We have to know, first of all, if it's the initial load or if it's the postback. And we determine that if there's something on the query string. Something on the query string means that is a postback. Now, I've been saying query string, but if we're using a post method instead of a get, it won't be on the query string, but it will come across another way. So I'm saying query string, but if it's with a post, it won't actually be on the query string. It will be part of the request, but you sort of get the idea, all right? I hope you get the idea. In other words, if there's something, if we see that there's some form data there, whether it's on the query string or part of the form collection, we know that it's the second time through. So we can tell this, whether it's displaying the form or this, based on whether there's some data from the form, whether it be on the query string, which is the examples we're going to give because that's the most visible, or if we are, there's nothing on there, we display the initial form. How do we tell if it's valid or not? Well, we're going to have a function to do that. We have a function that looks at it and determines whether whether or not the form data is valid, and then we know what to do. So I think we have a start for this. So we're going to take the start that we started last time, and we're going to finish it up. All I'm doing now is I'm going to copy stuff over to the web server. So right now we're missing a little snippet of code here. Let's see how it behaves. So I'll go here and type in localhost. Yeah, it doesn't work. All right, we broke it. This is where we left off last time. Why is it this way? Well, we're not distinguishing whether what mode they're in. All right, we are simply validating the form. Well, we don't need to validate the form the very first time. All right, we need to put in the check to see if there's anything on the query string. And what I am going to do on my include file. You don't absolutely have to put this in an include file. I put it in an include file simply because I wanted to do what? I wanted to just make this code really clean. So remember, one of the reasons we put stuff in an include file is because we want to reuse it. Another reason that we do it is just to make the code clean. And I got rid of some stuff from this form, so I'm gonna download a earlier version of it so I can copy and paste the form in. This is a good lesson for you. What I do by uploading the labs at the end of every class is I perform a rudimentary version of version control. So I can go back to an old version if there's a problem. And version control is important for software. You know, so if you make an update, what you would want to do is archive the version of the software before you started making the update. So I'm going to go and download this one, and I'm going to copy a snippet of code, the actual form, back into my working copy. I grabbed the wrong version. Oh, no. I have the right one. Duh. I'm at a different point than I thought. Okay, rewind. This is the page I want. Calculator. All right, there we go. I thought I had deleted the form. Good. All right, here's what I have. Here's the state I'm at. I'm at the state that I described on the board. In other words, there is server-side validation, and if I click this button, it takes me to that page, and so I'd have to go back to calculator to re-enter it. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to change calculator to include the validation code and the code to process the form. So. All right, my mistake. Sorry for any confusion. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to change this. So if it submits, it's going to post back to itself. If it does not submit, it will not post back to itself. Okay. So, I'm going to save it, and I'm going to copy it over to my server location. So now here's how my calculator works. I'm here, and notice when I click submit, oh, it tells me I'm missing age. That's the client-side validation. I put in the age. Notice what I get. I go back to that page, but I have on the query string, I got something. All right. So I can tell what mode I'm in based on whether it's the first time through or this, there's nothing on the query string. The second time through, there's something on the query string. Now, specifically, I'm going to look for the submit button because I know that if there's a value for the submit button it's the second pass through that I've clicked the submit button. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to include this include file. check range INC. Displaying of the form. Again, do I have to do this? No. But it's going to make my code look really clean. Bunch of HTML in this function. So I'm going to make this page. Do this. I'm going to perform the validation. But I'm not always going to perform the validation. I'm going to perform the validation if there is something for the submit button. How do I tell if there's something in a variable? I use the isSet method. So I'm going to say if isSet $_request btn submit if there is something in the submit button, then it's the second time through, so I can process the form. So I'm going to call the function to process the form. I'm going to say display output. Otherwise, I'm going to display the form. Now again, I mentioned that I put the form and the validation and the processing in an include file, even though this particular include file probably won't get reused. The reason I did this is simply to clean up my code. Look how clean this code is. Alright, I have my JavaScript stuff, which I could put in an external file. I have include files for the header, for the navigation, for the validation and processing logic. I look to see if there's something on the query string for the submit button. If there is, it's the second time through, and I'm going to display the output. If it's not, I know it's the first time through, and I'm going to display the form, and boom, there you go. Alright? So the nice thing about this is, I can, by having everything modularized in functions, I can isolate the code that I am interested in. So for example, if I don't like the way the form is, if there's a problem with the form, I go into this include file and look at the form logic to display the form. If there's a problem with the validation, I know it's isolated there. You could write this without any include files at all for this, and it would be a giant mess of what in the old days they called spaghetti code. You know, spaghetti code, if you see a noodle on one end of the plate, it might be attached to a noodle somewhere else on the plate. You just don't know until you start tugging on the strands of spaghetti. Alright? You don't want your code to be like that. You want your code to be like bento box code. Alright? In a bento box, you have a nice little section for everything
every dish or every item on your plate, and things are separated cleanly. So if you only want to eat the vegetable tempura, you go to that section of the box, and you don't have to worry about the rest of them. I don't know why I always use food examples, but I don't know. It just works for me. All right. Now, I haven't addressed the validation yet, other than the client-side validation. I haven't done anything with the server-side validation, but let's see what we have so far. So I'm going to make sure this is saved, and then I'm going to copy those over. And I'm going to go and request the calculator, and I'm getting an error. Again, we could stare at this, or yes?
The where it says is set request, you can submit, there's a square bracket.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Good eyes. And again, this is where an editor like Notepad++ helps you out. If you hadn't noticed that, I wouldn't spend hours staring at it. I would go in and, again, remember what I did. I went to the PHP any file and turned on to display errors. All right. So I would, you know, that would be a good way. That way I would get more detailed error messages. So let me recopy it over. Make sure I saved it first of all. I did. Okay, still getting an error. I am going to go and make that change. So let me find PHP any. Again, because the goofy way permissions are set up, I'm going to have to copy this file to the desktop, make my changes, and then move it over. It won't let me edit it in place. So I'm going to open up file location. I'm going to find it. I'm going to copy that PHP any to the desktop. I'm going to edit it. I'm going to search for errors. And right here, display errors equals off. I simply change that to on. Save it. Remember, there's a security risk if you display error messages. All right, unexpected brace on line 35. So let's go and look at line 35. I'm missing one of these. Remember, when it says unexpected break, over. And hopefully we're okay now. Oh, unexpected less than sign. Line 44. Oh. I never got out of PHP, so I don't need to go back into it. So there we go. We have the form. Now, I go in and I type in 33, and let's say I have 10 beats per second. I click calculate. Uncut error. Called undefined function in range. I think I'm missing another include file in here. I think that function was in heart. So let's see, my age is 44 and my rate per 6 seconds is 10. Tells me I'm in the optimal heart range. All right, cool. So notice what happens. Nothing on the query string, it displays the form. I submit it and there's something on the query string. Specifically, the button submit has a value. So I know to go and process the form. So I'm back to sort of where I was before server-side validation, because if I omit this, it doesn't know what to do with it, and it says I'm below there. It doesn't display that, because I have not put in my server-side validation on this. So, do I always want to do the validation? No. I only want to do the validation if it's the second time through. First time through, there's no need to do the validation because those fields, of course, aren't going to have values. So I'm going to go and do the validation, which is a function validate form. And so if it's the second time through, I'm going to call the validate form function. If that function is true. What does true mean? It means that the form data is valid. And what do I do if the form is valid? I display the output. If the form is not valid, what do? I display the form. Again, look how clean this code is. Very straightforward to read. See if postback. So, initial load, nothing on the query string, displays a form. I enter in valid data. It processes the form and tells me if I'm in the optimal range or not. Okay? I enter in invalid data. I put in garbage for the heart rate. It tells me that beats are not a number, which is true, and it redisplays a form. All right? So we're pretty much there. We're just missing one tiny little piece. All right? What don't you like about the way that this works? It displayed beats are not a number, and it redisplayed the form. But what's missing from the form? So if I go here, and I enter in that garbage, so I enter in 33, which is valid, but I enter in garbage for the beats per 6 seconds, and I click calculate, it tells me the beats are not a number, but notice the form. Yeah, it's blank. It doesn't show me what's wrong with the form. Or it doesn't show me the previously valid entries. All right? Which could be annoying, right? Because if you imagine, let's say, for example, that instead of 2 fields, you have 20 fields on the form. All right? Or you have, a lot of form fields, all right? It'd be a pain just because you forgot the zip code or something like that to have to go and re-enter all 20 fields. Ideally, I would want this form to be populated with the data that was submitted. Now, here's the good news. We can do that, right? Because the data that was submitted is up on the query string. So we can pluck that data out, and we can pop it in the form. All right? And that's cool. That's a good thing. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to set 2 variables. I'm going to set an age and beats. I'm going to say age equals an empty string and beats equals an empty string. Now, if they've clicked the submit button, I want to populate those variables from the query string. So age equals txt age txt beats. So now I have 2 variables. TXT age and TXT beats. I start them off as empty strings. If this is a resubmit, if this is a postback, then I'm grabbing those values from a query string. So when I display the form, I can set the value of those text boxes to the values of the variable age and the variable beats. Now, we could do this a couple different ways. I'm going to do it by passing arguments. because that's the preferred way to get data to a function, is to give it arguments. So I'm going to pass it age and beats. So I'm displaying the form and I'm telling it the previous values of age and beats. Now in the case of an initial load, these get initialized to empty strings. Or it could be whatever default value I want it to be. If I wanted to default the age to 40, I could default the age to 40. All right. But in this case, a default doesn't really make sense, right? How do I know how old the person is? There's probably not a typical age that the person is. Likewise, heart rate. So I don't want any default on this. So I'm going to populate it with an empty string on the initial load, and we're going to populate it with values I pulled from the query string on the postback. So I'm going to go and add two functions to this. Display form, dollar sign age, dollar sign beats. Now, how could I set the value of a text box? Well, the text box has a value attribute, right? Or I could give it a default. So, I'm going to do this. Value equals, quote, I'm going to pop in PHP mode. I'm going to output, change this to arg, I'm going to output the values for that argument. I'm going to do the same thing for beats. You can do a real similar thing if it happens to be another kind of form. So like if it's a form that does a drop down, you can look and check the value and output selected for the valid values, for the value that was selected. Now this is where PHP gets wild, right? Because notice where we are popping into PHP mode. We're popping into PHP mode in the middle of an HTML tag, all right? In the middle of a value attribute. This is where it's important for you to understand the HTML that you would need to be outputted. In other words, I would want the HTML to be something like value equals 10, or value equals 10. I'd want that attribute to look like that. So the HTML part is values equals. The PHP part is going to be this part right here, to put in the quotation marks the value of that variable. So the PHP part fills in the space between the quotes. So let me save this. And copy it over. So now, the initial load, we get blanks in there. Why? Because we initialized the value of those variables as an empty string. So therefore, we call the display form method, and we pass it two empty strings. So when we output that, we output the empty string. Now, let me make an error. I'll type in 30 for the age, and I'll type in some garbage for the beat. I click calculate. It tells me beat's not a number, And oh yeah, it shows me what I entered in before. So that way I can look and see what I did wrong. And again, if you can imagine there being, you know, a whole bunch of form fields, you would not want the user to have to go in and re-enter all the ones, including the good ones before. You'd want to bring the good ones over. And in fact, you want to bring the bad ones over too, because you want to show them what they did wrong, right? You don't want them wondering, like, gee, what did I type in there? I thought I entered a zip code in, or I thought I entered a valid rate in, or something like that. So you're going to show them what they entered in so they can look and say, oh, yeah, that's right, ASF isn't a valid value for that. I need to enter the correct value. And then if I do that, then I get the result. So this now works in all three modes. The initial mode, it displays a blank form. If I enter the data correctly, it shows the results correctly. And lastly, if I enter something and there's a server-side scripting validation error, it displays the error messages, and then it also redisplays the form, including the stuff that was entered. So the user can see what was previously entered to make any corrections, and they don't have to re-enter the stuff that was valid. So this is it for a postback. Because of server-side scripting validation, the postback is a preferred way to do that. Keeps everything on one page, and one page can display the form in the case of an initial load or in the case of there being a server-side validation error, and the same page does the processing of that form. All right. So if you can imagine a Amazon registration page, you enter the form in, initially the form's blank, click submit, it then looks for duplicate username or whatever, displays any error messages, and redisplays the form, including the stuff that you've entered in. However, if you have entered in everything correctly, when you hit submit, it will display, hey, you know, the database correctly updated or something like that. Any questions about this? All right. We'll see you over in lab.